Thank you. Hello, everyone, and welcome to Celestina's 54th happy hour. Some quick notes before I turn it over to Maya. We will be playing some videos during tonight's event, and if you enjoy higher resolution than Zoom offers, we'll give you the option of watching in YouTube Live by pasting a link in the chat. And if that doesn't matter too much to you, you can just stay here in Zoom as well. Please type your questions of widest interest for our guest artist in the chat. If the chat isn't your thing, we've made it as easy as possible for you to ignore it. And we also have some ground rules for the chat, which we'll paste in the chat. All right, now here's Maya.
Hi, everybody. My name is Maya Jasper-White. I am the co-director of Celestina along with Kevin. Hello. I'm pleased and honored to introduce everybody to Elliot Goldenthal. So, Elliot, you could learn so much about him by Googling. So I'll try to do this in one sentence. New York City lifer, Oscar-winning composer, three-time Academy Award nominee, Pulitzer Prize nominee, and the composer of dozens upon dozens of wide-ranging films, concert works, and productions for the stage, including opera, ballet, and theater. So before we say more about Elliot and start asking him questions, we would just like him to say hello and introduce the first two clips of music that we'll share from Titus and Frida. Hi, Elliot.
Hi, Maya. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. It's a miracle.
We get it.
Okay, great.
Would you mind setting us up for listening to the clip from Titus, Eros, and the clip from Frida?
Me?
Yes. Tell us a little bit about what we're going to hear.
The first thing is arrows to the gods, right?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. So it's Shakespeare is Titus, actually, as one of his, it's his first drama. And it's a very, very insane, out there play. Very bloody, very, very theatrical. It's also funny in a dark way, and its language is unbelievable. And this movie that Julie Taymor directed at the turn of the last century, 2000, has a great cast. Anthony Hopkins, I should mention, he plays Titus, is an amazing, and Jessica Lange, and it's great cast, but it is Shakespeare, and it's Julie set it in a time which is no time. It feels contemporary. It feels like it's like an extension of ancient Rome, but yet there's automobiles from the 1940s and 50s and video games and et cetera, so it's like no specific time, but it's a time of the general human condition as Shakespeare has perfected in his works. And it's a real treat if you get a chance to watch that movie. In this scene, Titus, he's a great general, fighting against Roman general fighting against the Goths, probably 240 AD, somewhere on in that time. And he has a kind of a rival. He set up to be a king, Saturninus. I don't want to go into too many details, but he's trying to get messages to Saturninus. He's outside of the gates of his castle, and he decided to petition the gods by writing letters and attaching it to borrowed arrows and having his archers, release the arrows into the sky with messages to the gods. It's just insane. It makes total no sense whatsoever, but those arrows breach the wall and goes into the Saturninus's castle, Saturninus knows that Titus has something up. He's planning something. So he's enraged. My challenge was to set up the archers, the action of the bow and arrow and shafts of bows flying through the air, and also the rage of Saturninus running through the castles, breaking arrows and basically saying Titus has something up his sleeve.
Okay.
So then the music, I wanted to very, very, even though it's an action scene, I wanted to be very, very stingy with the motivic material. And da-da-da-dum, bom, bom. That's the entire motivic material for the whole piece of music. And see if you can follow it at all.
Okay, great. Okay, and I understand that Titus is one of your personal favorite works that you've done in that space. And Frida is the one for which you won the Academy Award. So can you briefly tell us about the song that we'll segue directly into?
Well, the song from Frida. Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's a song, Alcoba Azul, just a little small blue room. The title infers that as very sexy stuff taking place in the room, basically. It's a party where Frida Kahlo, a great Mexican painter, and is dancing a tango with another woman at the party, and around a lot of people, including her husband Diego Rivera, and it shows her sexual freedom at the time, independence, and it's kind of a tango, but it's not specifically in any tango traditional style. So I wrote it for Lila Downs, who is a beautiful American and Mexican, both. As she's bicultural in that sense. Her mother's family is from Oaxaca, and I believe her father's family is from Minnesota, something in the Midwest. So she's completely bicultural, and I loved her voice. So I wrote this little song for her. For
the amazing
movie. It had to be filmed. The song had to be written before the movie because she had to learn it and she had to sing it on set. Live action. Okay.
Interesting.
Thank you.
Wonderful. So as you can see in the chat, you are free to go to YouTube Live or stay here in Zoom.
Thank you.
noche, todo el día.
Ask you to unmute yourself again. Elliot, you know, I was reading a Sound on Sound article in which you described your film scoring process, and I thought it was fascinating the way that you, it seems like everything happens out of a kind of a series of improvisations. Can you describe what your process is?
In movies.
Movies, yes.
Well, the last thing you heard was a song, and it had to be written before the images of the movie was even there. So the best tool for that was a pencil and eraser, the old-fashioned way. That's just sat down at the piano, and I worked on the lyrics, and once the lyrics were right, and I had it translated and to the proper Spanish, and it was, and then it was a back and forth with myself and Julie Taymor, and I sang the song. So the demo was properly clicked out in the right time and everything. So the choreographer had to get the right feel for the scene, because the choreography and the learning of the song has to be pre-recorded and done in advance. So in that sense, it was very, very traditional songwriting. The other one, Arrows to the Gods, it was temp scored to another score I did for Cobb called Reno Ho. It was a very, very orchestral, full of energy car ride in the movie Cobb, where a car is going down a mountain in Reno and out of control. It's almost a crash scene. So the editor used that, and I had to write something completely different, but with the same feeling. I think that's the worst thing in the world I ever suggested to someone in a movie. They usually have temp music, and it's very difficult to live up to the piece, especially when it's Bach or Mahler or something. But in this case, it was even worse because it was me. So I was lucky once. So trying to find that something in the same character, but completely different, that's a challenge. And the movie Frida was done after Titus, and there was a horrible experience I had with these temping with my own music from previous scores. I asked Julie, and Julie Taymor was nice enough to say, okay, no temp music. You do the whole thing from scratch. It was more of a pleasant experience at working that way. But it's very difficult for the director because they don't have a finished produced score to share with the studios.
I see.
In this case, it was Harvey Weinstein, and he stayed out of the way in this particular case at this time.
But so the article I read, it sounded like sometimes you will just watch the movie over and over again and then just sort of start improvising and...
you know, that's correct. I think an excellent way to sort of morph yourself or to graft yourself into the fabric of the movie is to almost telepathically be there in some way. And I find playing to the scenes, like silent movie a pianist in the 1920s or whatever, to feel like I'm part of the ensemble, to feel like I get a feeling for the breathing of the actors, the rhythm of the edits, the sense of whether it's dread or whether it's the light of the room or the architecture you're writing in.
I see.
So that's very helpful. That's the first step. So I feel like I'm a part of the ensemble. Mm.
And what about for concert music? How do you approach, what's your process for composing for the stage?
Well, it depends on the project. If it's a symphonic work, a symphony, for example, I have no frame or reference other than the motivic material itself. So that's very confident, comforting, but I don't have any crutches. It's only that, you know, everyone is not Beethoven, you know, but the idea of da 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 da, and it's the whole universe Beethoven created with that little motive.
Yeah.
That's something, in a way, that's very comforting to know it's possible to create and spin off little galaxies which with a little connective motive. And if it's a trumpet concerto, I just finished a trumpet concerto. It's more, you have something to hang your hat on, the range of the instrument, the endurance of the performer, et cetera. So it's a little less scary, you know?
I see.
And if it's a ballet, if it's opera, you have, it's programmatic music. So you have something that you can relate to along the way.
We're going to watch a recent world premiere, October Light, next. Mm-hmm. And would you mind introducing that before we take a watch?
Yes, it was a symphonic adagio. Was dedicated to Carl St. Clair, who's a conductor of the Pacific Symphony Orchestra. Mm-hmm. And he was he was very kind to me to premiere my many works, my symphony, my oratorio, 3 years. So it was a delight to write something for him. But it's very, very wistful. The piece was... it premiered last year, December.
Thank you. Wonderful. Okay. And just in case some of you are new to Solistina, two of our resident artists are principal members of the Pacific Symphony. Ben Smolin is a principal flutist, and Meredith Crawford is the principal violist. So you'll see them in the video. So.
Thank you.
Thanks.
I'm so sad to have missed. I was a member of Pacific Symphony too for many, many years, and not a member when they played that piece. I was there for Symphony in G sharp and for the Othello Ballet. That's where I first became acquainted with your work, but that's a stunning piece. Just so everybody knows, that's just an excerpt from that piece, not the complete piece. And if we're lucky, maybe someday it will be recorded. Elliot, can you tell us a little bit about what you call your triple life as a composer for the concert stage, for film, and for other kinds of productions like theaters, ballets, and operas? I think we're specifically interested in why you think there are so few composers who do that these days.
I can't possibly answer the last part because I don't know. I suspect it's not true. I think they're out there, but we don't know. But the first part is easy to answer. When I was, the late teens, or I was studying with John Corigliano at the time, and I remember he saying to me, the composer should go where they're wanted. And, it's one thing to write, your 15th string quartet. If you don't have anyone to play it, I found in New York, when I was that age, there was a lot of freelance, little theater companies dance companies, modern dance companies, the classical theater, Shakespeare, commedia, this or that, and not only New York, but throughout the East Coast at the time, and Berkeley Rep, for example, and it was a great feel. It was a great thing to work with live actors, live dancers, sometimes improvising on the spot, creating a theater from nothing. Mm-hmm. And on the other hand, composing things for Shakespeare, where the dialogue is so difficult to compose to. You don't want to get in the way, but you want to enhance the scene if it's playing along with dialogue. And it introduced me to a lot of directors, Andre Servan and Julie Taymor at the time, amongst many others, the choreographer Laura Lubavitch, et cetera. So I had hands-on ability. At the same time, I was writing chamber music, smaller pieces, so that was able to be played. My string quartet, bass sonata, brass quintet, woodwind quintets, et cetera, because it was practical. I can get it played. One thing left to another. I was like 19 or 20 years old. I did two horrible movies, but they still was movies. One called Blank Generation with Andy Warhol was in it. Rigid Hell and the Voidoids for punk fans. Another movie called Cocaine Cowboys, which is absolutely horrible. But I got it budget. He said, here's a budget. Here's a budget like $4,000. Here, compose it. Hire an orchestra, conduct it, copy it, orchestrate it, hand it over. Then oh. I did. And then the sad part, they didn't want to pay me afterwards. So, it was an introduction to all the scallywags and the ruthless people in this business. I felt a good balance between personal work, which is concert work, communal work, which is especially in film, where you have you're working in a collaborative fashion. And I meant to say communal work, which is where you're working with an ensemble of actors and dancers. And it's very, very, when you in a room where everyone is perspiring and creating and frustrated and have a glimpses of success and then failures and everyone, it's a beautiful way to have a tactile feeling of drama.
Elliot, we'd love to hear about your influences. I mean, from you know, your youth and I mean, I guess all the way up to now too, if you wouldn't mind. Teachers and, you know, just how you have this, I mean, you have this incredible variety in the things that you write. So yeah, we'd just like to know about that.
Well, I grew up in Brooklyn, New York, and in an apartment building where I heard everyone else's music at all times through the window. And it was a multi-ethnic, but multicultural. So at all times, I'm hearing, you know, different periods of music, and I'm smelling different pieces of the people cooking in the alleyways, et cetera, et cetera. So I was, what's natural to me is a multicultural kind of feel. So I don't have any, it's not like Bach where he stayed in Leipzig, wherever he didn't leave his, area. It seemed like the whole world of people lived in that area of Brooklyn, like 30 or 40 different languages are spoken. Yeah. And it's funny, that's the same, similar neighborhood where Aaron Copland grew up in, uh-huh. and John Corigliano grew up in, and Max Roach was living at the time, and et cetera, et cetera. George Gershwin, you know, but so it had a, you know, multicultural feel. And I think it affected my music.
I see. You spent some time with Aaron Copland.
Well, I was so lucky. He wasn't my official teacher. My official teacher was John Corigliano. However, I had a girlfriend at the time who was working for Aaron Copland year-round for a couple of years in upstate New York. And I stayed there with her in Aaron's house. And Aaron really liked when I played four hands with his compositions. Okay. I think we found composition is in his basement, like a piece called Rogue on a ballet that he wrote in his teens. And the early works were like his early, organ symphony and things like that. And we sat there at the piano for hours and hours and days and days. And it was, a delight to ask him any questions. He was very generous. I was talking about months, even bleeding into years of doing this, every night, at the piano.
Yeah.
But my principal teacher I studied with for 8 years, was John Corigliano. Mm. And, but there is a connection between them. And that's the feeling that it's just composed music. The forum, whether it's medium, doesn't matter. Whether it's movie, ballet, opera, chamber music. The cinema is very important for those people, and it's a living art, you know.
Yeah. Okay, so the next video we're going to watch is The Homecoming from Cobb. Yes. Would you mind just setting that up briefly?
Well, it's about Ty Cobb, and he was not the nicest person ever. He was a really crummy person, I should say. I'm thinking of other words, but I won't say them.
Okay.
But at this point, he realized the son of a bitch he was. He's driving home, and it's very, very wistful. He realized that it's a movie that Ron Shelton directed. Mm-hmm. It was quite beautiful. And he wanted something really wistful, like the end of the early 20th century Vienna school or something like that, mixed in with a quote from a Baptist hymn. He gave me a opportunity to write a adagio in a baseball movie. So that's very rare.
And great. Go ahead, please. No, please, go ahead.
No, it's also, I think, I'm not sure the recording you have, but I think it's a Ghent orchestra, festival orchestra, with Dirk Brasset conducting. It was recorded this year. If it's not that recording, it's the original film recording.
Okay. No, this is the one that we have, the one that you mentioned. Okay.
Yes, yes.
All right. So once again, you can listen here in Zoom, or you can listen in YouTube Live, where the quality is a little bit better. Thank you.
Thank you.
That is stunning. For those of you who aren't following the chat, I do want to mention that there are playlists on YouTube that are literally called Best Elliot Goldenthal Adagios. So now I hope you can understand why. So I will take a quick timeout to do our requisite nonprofit pitch. These events, this is our 54th consecutive happy hour. They're free to the public week by week, but they are not free to produce. So we are immensely grateful for those of you who've already supported Celestina and the production of these events, which will continue indefinitely, even when live concerts come back. If you are in a position to give either again or for the first time, any little bit helps. So please consider it. You can see in the chat what else your donations might support. So Elliot, I wanted to ask you our last question for the night, which is about what it takes to convert something that you've written for one medium that's not primarily about the music into a concert work or a recorded piece of music. That's something that I've read you really enjoy. Can you tell us why and how it is that you go about that?
Well, if you're a composer, it's always about the music, musical contribution to a whole, to a collaboration. The collaboration is to a moving image that might go at 24 frames per second, and whether it's a big action or movie or a very, very, very delicate eternal movie. The joy for me is to bring it across, to have it interpreted again by a different orchestra, even if I'm not there, you know, to have it shared with a community event, the orchestra playing, the audience in participating in the evening. So In films, sadly, you hear the recording session, it gets frozen in time. But, if an orchestra interprets it, when I was quite young, I realized most of your works, and hopefully, is performed after you're dead, you know? So, when people ask me about anything about legacy, and I think the legacy is, are the parts correct? Is there mistakes? You know, so, you know, it's out there, you know, let it blow in the wind. But it's, to answer your question, it's very gratifying to get it unglued from the cinematic tether.
Yeah, interesting. So like I mentioned earlier, I had the great good fortune of playing in the pit when your Othello ballet came to the Music Center in LA.
And I was very difficult.
Yes, it was difficult. It was and very, very fun. And I was so pleased to see that it had been recorded not that long ago as a symphony. So that's the last thing we're going to listen to before we open it up to the audience questions that we have time for. So here comes the Tarantella, an excerpt from the Othello Symphony.
Thank you.
That was one of my favorite parts from that, playing that piece. It's so memorable. That was easily
that's so weird to excerpt that one weird stuff.
I loved it. I just loved it. Had to share.
Oh, the audience loved it too.
The artist said, that's my kind of heavy metal. That's so true.
Elliot, we have some really wonderful questions from the audience.
That was a saxophone, by the way. Bruce Williamson was a saxophonist and he let it rip in that particular music passage. Okay.
Very cool.
You're saying, Kevin?
Oh, I was just saying that we have some great questions from the audience.
Great.
Okay, so Keon, if you wouldn't mind unmuting yourself, you can ask your question directly.
Thank you so much. So my question is about your oratorio, Firewater Paper. It's one of my favorite concert works. Sadly, I wasn't born in time to see it premiered, but I hope I can see it one day. And I'm just curious to hear about the conception of the work.
Well, the conception was, at the time, it was, I think it was 1995. It was the 20th anniversary of the end of the conflict in Vietnam. And you know, it was, it didn't stop the atrocities around the world. And in one way, like Benjamin's Britain War Requiem or something, it's when you embark on something like that, you realize the desperation of the subject matter. And it was a full, for those who don't know it, if it's for full orchestra, cello obbligato, with that Yo-Yo Ma recorded it, and chorus and soloists. And it's basically in Latin, French and Vietnamese. So it has also a children's chorus. It was a full evening. Carl Sinclair premiered it, and Seiji Ozawa toured the United States with it, including Carnegie Hall and the Kennedy Center. And it was very moving piece to be asked to be commissioned to work like that. The poetry was based on Latin mass and Yosef Kumanyaka, who was a contemporary Afro-American, brilliant poet. And I don't know what to say. It's a long work and it takes a lot of attention span to listen to, I have to thank you for listening to that, you know? And I see a Beatles poster behind you, and it reminds me of another project that I love doing across the universe.
Elliot, it's 7 o'clock right now, and we don't want to impose on your time too much. Are you all right to take another?
No, I'm fine. I already had dinner.
Oh,
now I'm playing hooky for my composition, so I'm happy in that way.
Okay. Wonderful. I'd like to, since we're going jumping around the questions a little bit, you just mentioned Across the Universe, and Rob Berliner had a question about that. He asks, when I saw Across the Universe, it was instantly one of my favorite films. And so much of that has to do with your inspired reimagining of the Beatles classics. Can you talk a bit about your approach, how the songs were chosen and integrated, and especially how you approached reinvigorating songs most audiences would have heard countless times? And might we ever see it on stage?
Well, that's... Julie Taymor wants to put in the stage, but you know, it's a complicated to raise money, etc., to get the right people to do it. But Rob, your question, my approach to it is that the Beatles are composers, the members, the John Lennon and Paul McCartney and Harrison was composers, and their band was something separate. And the licks, the riffs on the of the band is completely familiar to us. It's like no matter what you play, if you play a Beatles tune, you hear the performances, the little riffs in between the tunes. So I decided to, for the most part, leave them out and approach the brilliance of the melodies and the lyrics. The opening song is Girl. It was scored for cello playing mainly harmonics and glass harmonica. That's the scene where the leading character, Jude, is sitting on a beach and he's singing this song, a different tempo than the Beatles' conception, but yet it brings across the beauty of the melody. And I think various tunes had various approaches, because it's drama, and it's not meant for a concert stage. For example, the song Blackbird, I decided to take out all the thirds in the harmonies. So it sounds very, very almost like hollow, like Appalachian music in a sense, not lush with all the beautiful thirds that Paul McCartney wrote. So it seemed fresh in a different way, not any better, not qualitatively, quality wise, but fresh. And every song had that, I Want to Hold Your Hand. I love the tempo of that. I slowed it down completely. And it had a pulsation of the, acoustic bass. And is a, also, it was like 38 tunes on the album. I was responsible for 28 of those, and T-Bone Burnett did a great job, and T's Gold did a great job, and I was also working with a band apart from individual musicians called the Secret Machines, and they're a great, great band. If you have a chance to hear their other work, is really wonderful. Any other questions about it? Rob? Yeah, okay.
Sorry, we have a lot of questions. We have a question from, I'm going to say this wrong, I'm sure. Is it Unica? Unica Tanzel? You can unmute yourself and ask your question.
Hi, yeah, it's Unica.
Unica, oh, thank perfect, you. Okay.
Hi, Unica.
Go ahead, please.
Hi, yeah. First of all, Mr. Goldenthal, I am such a fan of your, not only your film works, but also your concert works. So my question is very specific. I got chosen to study with Professor Corigliano as well for this fall. And he also mentioned—
You're lucky.
Yeah, he mentioned about you a lot. And as someone who's now living in LA, do you think it is wiser to stay in LA to start a career as a freelancer or an assistant, or to spend 2 years master's in Juilliard studying with Professor Corigliano? And my goal is to be like you, to be someone who write not only film works, but also concert works. Thank you so much.
Well, John is a part of my blood. And I met him when I was 7 years old. And I knew him ever since. And I studied with him for 8 years. But I can't say how lucky it is to work with him as a student. So I would recommend studying with him because, you know, that's something that's irreplaceable. Unless he moves to Los Angeles, that's another option. But that's my advice. But you, I love your setup there.
Oh, yeah. it's a fake background.
Oh, it's a fake background.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you so much.
We had a couple of questions about the Batman scores. Mm-hmm. Alexander, Dion, you can unmute yourself.
Yes, hi, thank you for doing this. I've been a lifelong fan. Really, I used to play with my action figures and humming your main theme for Batman forever. I especially like the music for Batman and Robin, and I hope we'll get an album release someday. I was wondering, what is your fondest memory from working on the Batman project?
Well, a fondest memory is basically Joel Schumacher. And his attitude of the film was he didn't want to take that subject too seriously. Tim Burton's movies were brilliant. And the late so brilliant, but Joel had a feeling of almost disposable culture, almost like comic books and nothing too reverential. And in a sense that gave me the freedom of not to take myself too seriously. And that was very liberating. And you mentioned the action figures. That's how I got the theme myself. I thought, how am I gonna compose it, Batman theme, And I said, how do I approach that? And I said, I know. When I was like 3 years old or 4 years old and I was playing with toys, every child writes their own score, every child. So I said, what is this sound? I wrote the score already when I was three. If you don't take yourself too seriously, these things that's kind of wonderful can emerge.
Oh, that's great. Thank you.
Alexandra, thank you for listening. Yeah.
Excellent. We'd like to have Demetris unmute yourself. Go ahead, please.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi. Thanks so much for doing this. Huge fan of your music. I love it. I love your brass writing, the string ostinatos. And I'm curious, you mentioned in a couple of interviews that you love the glass harmonica. And I'm curious, do you ever plan on writing a concerto? Because I know that the Othello has a lot of glass harmonica in it. But do you ever plan on writing a concerto specifically for glass harmonica?
No. It has to be like six people in the room to enjoy it. Because I guess it can be written for something that's recorded. Mozart actually wrote... he was commissioned to write a piece for the glass harmonica. And I forgot the name of it, but he wrote it late in his life. It was an instrument that was codified and invented by Benjamin Franklin, believe it or not. And in the Othello ballet, it was played by a live musician. She was also a celeste player and played the glass harmonica. It was, it's great to hear live, and and it's a not many players out there that play. And I heard, I once heard someone showed me a street musician. I think it was on the streets of Prague or something. You can look it up, on YouTube. He was playing Carmen, and he was playing Bach, the Bach Fantasy in F minor or something on the glass harmonica, or actually on champagne glasses on the street with all the chromatics in between and everything and up tempo. It's unbelievable. It's a good idea, but I don't know it. But,
it's just a very interesting instrument, I think, too. It has like this very transcendent sound.
I agree. Don't give me other things to do. I'm still working
on it. Well, Elliot, to that end, do you mind telling us what you're working on right now?
I'm working on a piece called Prison Lady Bird. It's in the Polish language. It's commissioned by an orchestra to be played as planned at this point in Gdańsk and in Krakow. And it's poetry by a woman named Barbara Sadowska. It's very dark poetry, and it involves isolation and a oppressive government, it's very difficult for me because I'm not a Polish speaker. I thought it was going to be easier than I thought it was, but the West Slavic language is not easy for me to. So in a good way, I spend a lot of time on the sounds of the language. And I'm hearing words as if I heard the word for the first time. I'm learning a language like I'm a human being learning to speak, for the first time. So it has its advantages, but it has a challenging obstacles for me as well.
Interesting.
I should say it's for soprano and a symphony orchestra, a song cycle. Should be about 40 minutes long.
Wow. So just a few more questions, if you don't mind. We have a question from Stephen. Stephen, you can unmute yourself. Let's see. If Stephen is not there, I'll ask his question. Let's see, hold on. Okay. He asks, who are your favorite composers and how do they influence your orchestration technique? For example, your orchestration of the brass in Batman Forever and Interview with a Vampire are practically signature giveaways of your sound.
Well, if he's referring to the trills and the high French horns and things like that, if he's referring to that, and the last, okay, let me, fair enough. I have to say, one of the big influences on me was Polish composer Krzysztof Penderecki, who died this year. I had the good fortune of meeting him a few times and going to his house and talking about, like a fan at his feet, when I was in high school, I remember cracking open some of the scores and listening to the brass writing, especially in a piece he wrote called Pittsburgh Overture. And is also as many symphonic works. And I was very, very taken by, I was it's like listening to the primal screams of John Coltrane for the first time, you know, or something like that. It's a very, very unnerving experience to hear Penderecki in this 1960s period. Also, John Corigliano carried on some of the technique. Some of the technique involves also aleatoric orchestration, which is in boxes and indications of semi-improvisatory controlled improvising within a narrow pitch and rhythmic structure. And it's something I especially introduced with my own work in cinematic wise in Alien 3, which is a new album just came out on Alala Records this past week. It was one of my favorite scores with David Fincher.
There's time for one last question. Let's see, Jordan is curious what you're listening to now. Do you mind sharing some inspiration for everyone's playlists?
You know, I'm a habitual China. I turn the dials. I listen to stuff. I was listening to a Northern Mexico accordion music, and I was listening to a Mongolian, throat singing, I was listening to the Goldberg Variations of Bach the other day, Glenn Gould, for some reason, and every time I listen to these things, I'm just like, in a state of wonder. I'm just like a little kid.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, we do. Thank you so much, Elliot, for your time. You were really generous with us to stay, especially.
Thank you so much. Yeah, I enjoyed myself.
Thank you, Elliot.
Have a nice day. Okay. Bye.
You too. Bye-bye. Okay, everybody else, we hope you'll join us next week for our 55th happy hour with a college classmate of Kevin's. Kevin, why don't you... set that up for everybody.
Yeah. So cellist Amy Barston, she's, I think even before we met, she had been a soloist with the Chicago Symphony, but just all around brilliant musician. She has a career as an equal career as a performer and a teacher. She teaches at Juilliard. And her husband, Adam Silverman, is a widely performed composer. And he has a really, interesting, he's developed this kind of very interesting way of getting commissions, which I'll let him talk about. But they kind of threatened to include some chickens in the happy hour as well, and some other things. So yes, part of it will be very unpredictable because that's how they are. But they're just like the loveliest people, and I'm sure it's going to be a lot of fun. Yeah.
My gosh, I see Joel Iwataki. Hi.
Oh, hey, Joel.
Someone who worked with Elliot many, many times. If you'd like, Joel, you can unmute yourself and say hi. We'd love to hear from you, but no pressure.
Hey, Joel.
Hi. So happy you had Elliot. It's so wonderful to hear him. It's such brilliant and funny guy.
And so many scores. I mean, I feel like for those of you, we didn't get to some of the questions, but I mean, there are just so many scores that we can talk about, so many iconic scores. Yeah. So, yeah.
Joel, do you mind sharing what your work has been with Elliot? I think the listeners would love to know.
I started on his first Hollywood film, which was Pet Sematary. He had recorded it with in New York with, not St. Martin's in the Fields, but an orchestra, a chamber
Orpheus?
Orchestra.
Orpheus? Pardon me? Orpheus?
No.
No?
Then he came mixed it here, and that was the first time I met him, and at the time I was actually trying to be a composer myself. And I met him, and I was really just not well suited to film composing. I was slow, but I heard his music, and I thought if I could live a second or third life, this is what I would like to be writing. I would just love to be able to work on music like this. So I was fortunate enough that we got along together really well, and I've worked with him ever since. And I have to say that you picked my favorite scores, Titus, number one, and Cobb. No one knows Cobb. It's such a beautiful, incredible score. And of course, Frida and Batman. Yeah, there's so many. Yeah. I just have to say one quick story about that. Fugue that you played from Titus, the first piece that you played from Titus, Arrow to the Gods. Because of Julie Taymor, the director's really demanding ideas about music, it was a problem with the temp, you know, she had fallen in love with the temp score. We had gotten to London, we recorded it in London at Abbey Road. We had done our first night of recording, and she decided he needed to rewrite that piece. So we're staying at this beautiful hotel in London called the Halcyon, and everyone else on the crew, Tease Goldberg, music producer and the electronic music producer, and Bob Elhi, the orchestrator, we're all staying at this beautiful hotel along with Julie and the producer. And that night had a wonderful, great first session at Abbey Road. We're all elated, and we all went down to the bar downstairs and we're partying, and Elliot had to write this piece. The Arrows to the Gods, and I said, "What are you going to do?" And he said, and he had a synth set up in a little room. So, well, I'm thinking about a few. So that night, we were partying all night, and every hour or so, I would go in and check on him and see how he was doing. And it started out as just the da da bum 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 bum, and then the second voice came in, and the next hour, you know, and more, and then in about 3 or 4 hours. We had that whole piece composed. It just blew my mind. It was like, you know, watching Mozart work in real time. Yeah, it was such a joy to work with him.
Wow, that's an incredible story. Thank you for sharing that. And to think that, you know, just an hour ago, he said, "Oh yeah, there's just this little theme. Da, 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 I'll let you hear it." You know, to hear the story behind that is really cool. So
he was sweating. He was sweating and he was suffering because we were all part of it.
Crazy.
Thank you, Joel.
Thank you so much.
And good to see you.
Thanks.
Maybe should we just take a couple of questions? If there's anybody who's new to Celestina who has some questions about the happy hours or about the organization, feel free to unmute yourself. I believe you can unmute yourself, or you can let Marissa know if you have a question. I really wanted to ask him about the soundtrack for Final Fantasy, which is that animated movie, because I remember sitting in the theater watching that and just thinking, it's what I wrote in the chat, it felt like a movie had been created to a symphony, you know, and just unapologetically symphonic music for this animated movie. So let's see.
He raised hands.
Or you can type in the chat that you have a question to, if you have one.
Yeah. If there are none, we are happy to wish you all a wonderful week and hope that you will join us next week or in the future for another one of these. And hopefully as the weeks go by, we'll be able to share some plans that we have for playing live. Anyhow, thank you so much for joining us tonight.
Thank you so much, once again, for a wonderful evening.
Thank you so much, Anne.
We love it. We learn so much. It makes us so happy. Thank you.
Good. Okay, bye-bye, everyone.
All right, thanks, everyone.